Welcome everyone to another edition to As Above, So Below Radio. I'm your host, Martin Hodgson, and it gives me great pleasure to have you tuning in today. When you get a chance, please visit the newly revamped website holisticadvocate.com. For any updates on news as well as interviews, please visit my blog. Also, take a moment to subscribe and become a member. Not only will you gain access to the commercial-free subscriber-based interviews, but also treat yourself to an assortment of fascinating people worth listening to. Today's guest is Mary Rodwell. A former registered nurse and midwife, Mary is currently the founder and principal of an organization called ACERN, an acronym for the Australian Close Encounter Resource Network. Based in Queensland, Australia, Mary has worked since 1994 in private practice as a professional counselor, a hypnotherapist, a metaphysical teacher, a researcher, a Reiki master, and an international speaker. She is also the author of a book titled Awakening: How Extraterrestrial Contact Can Transform Your Life. Join me in welcoming Mary as she discusses the awakening paradigm shift in human consciousness. First of all, I want to extend to you, Mary, a warm welcome for being on As Above, So Below Radio. Now, you've been profiled in many interviews, but for any of the listeners out there, can you just give us a brief introduction on, you know, your background and what got you started on the path towards being a hypnotherapist and researcher into paranormal experiences?
Well, I started out in a very normal profession as a nurse and a midwife nearly 40 years ago, and then obviously had my family. I've got three adult children and four grandchildren now, and I sort of got drawn into counselling, became a professional counsellor working for the National Health Service in England initially, and then when I moved to Australia, working in grief and bereavement, family counselling, pregnancy counselling, all those kinds of what I call normal human experiences, or at least the ones that are considered normal. And it was interesting that when I went into private practice, that then I started to get some more unusual experiences. Interestingly, when you work with grief and bereavement, people can often have profound experiences when they lose somebody close to them, for example, and are aware of, you know, that loved person is trying to connect with them in some way. They may feel them around, or they may sense that they're around. So there was certainly some anomalous experiences related to, you know, the whole afterlife experience that, you know, some people have, the near-death experiences, etc. I came across those kinds of things. But it was really a gentleman called Ellis Taylor, who's now an author and a good friend of mine, who came to me because he'd heard I was open-minded. And he said, look, Mary, there are support groups for everything you can imagine, but there's no support groups for this. For this experience, people just think you're a loony. And proceeded to tell me that he'd wake up in the morning with marks on his body, shaved areas, felt like he was taken up on spacecraft. His partner was terrified that the relatives wouldn't come to the house because they thought it was demons. And he was in a really, really, confused place where he felt there was no one that would listen or even acknowledge that this was a reality. Fascinating and synchronously, as we all know, these wonderful coincidences or synchronicities. Mm-hmm. Two months prior to that, I picked up two books. One of them was Abduction, Human Encounters with Aliens, that Dr. John Mack, a former professor of psychiatry who sadly is no longer with us. And he had, you know, in a most beautiful way, done all the psychological testing. He had worked with a number of those that had had encounters and came to the conclusion that for him, this was a reality, which was an amazing statement for a, you know, for a professor of psychiatry. And on top of that, I read the classic book, of course, by Whitley Strieber, Communion. So literally, it was almost like the universe was preparing me for my first client. And within a fortnight, I got another one. It was like I thought this was unusual and strange, but no, it wasn't, because somebody else walks through the door. and doing advanced counselling at the time, I took his case to supervision. And what was fascinating, Martin, with this was that as I took him to this case, thinking, I put down Fantasy Pro and I put, you know, all the other things, and is it real? As part of my possible hypotheses, thinking that this wonderful group of professionals, there was a uniting minister, social workers, psychologists. What I expected was them all to come up with what I would consider the standard response. But interestingly, it opened the door for them to say to me all of the unusual experiences they'd had. So instead of saying this guy was crazy, they all started to say, you know, I used to have strange experiences, or I was in a house that was haunted, or... And so it literally was open sesame. And what this said to me was, first, we need to know what this is. And secondly, everyone in some way or another may very well have some kinds of unusual experiences that don't fit into the box, this third dimensional box that we are taught is reality, when in fact all of us at some point or another are aware we have another aspect to ourselves that is tapping into the non-physical, multidimensional reality that is in fact, I believe, the true nature of reality, and certainly not the limited third dimensional one we're programmed into. So in effect, Ellis was the catalyst, and I've often joked with him and said, you know, it's all your fault that I've gone down this very weird and wonderful rabbit hole, but I wouldn't change a thing, Martin.
Great. Now, it's interesting that you, you know, as a result of what you've been doing, you've written a fascinating book called Awakening, and you've also established an organization called ACERN, which is a professional support network for those needing counseling, support, hypnotherapy, and information to those who have had, what, anomalous experiences?
Yes, and that was inspired by a wonderful organization, ACET in America, the Academy of Clinical Close Encounter Therapists. Mm-hmm. And these are professionals, you know, doctors, nurses, psychologists, etc., that have banded together to offer support to experiences, not only just in America, but they have obviously clinicians in other parts of the world. And I became a member of that, but also felt that we needed something of a similar vein in Australia. And that was really my inspiration for creating ACERN, because I wanted to create a credible professional resource that would allow people to share safely in a confidential environment whatever it was that they were experiencing that they felt was perhaps, you know, something that they couldn't necessarily speak about to anyone else.
Okay. Now, you also use the term starseed to the children who have this deep connection to the stars. And realistically, we all have a deep connection to the stars. But these children in particular, the ones that are being classified as indigo or crystal children, you've talked about these children, and some of the characteristics you cite are the following. Some feel that they've been dumped on this planet. They eschew materiality. They communicate with animals. They feel that everything has a consciousness. Many feel totally alone and isolated. Many feel that what they're taught in schools make no sense at all. Many challenge their teachers or authority. And many struggle with the term God, and I'm certain the list goes on and on. And I remember back in the early 1990s, I came across the term star people and the tie-in with Brad Steiger, who cited four kinds of star people. I think he cited here refugees, utopians, energy essences, and reincarnated ETs, all of whom came to Earth to help prepare for great changes. And some of these changes will be preceded, you know, by worldwide disasters. Mm-hmm. So, Mary, in your research, is there this urgency from these star people, these star children, to fulfill their mission while on Earth?
Absolutely. And for me, the reason I focus a great deal on the children mm-hmm. is because I feel that, first of all, they haven't had the programming that the adults have, which also compromises to a certain extent the integrity of the data that they may espouse. For example, the children don't watch talk shows, they don't read books on this. Only recently, what was fascinating for me was two parents, one of them in Sydney, mm-hmm. With two daughters, who contacted me because his daughter had drawn the classic kind of ET being, only this one had the big eyes and a flat head. Sometimes they're like that, which she called, the doctor being that mm-hmm. came to see her.
Right.
But she also mentioned the new earth, and that there is going to be a new earth, and they were going to go to this new earth. Synchronously, within only a week or two of that, a gentleman from Canada contacted me, sent me a script. This is a strange kind of writing that some of the star seeds actually find themselves automatically writing without any conscious thought. Some of the script looks a bit like hieroglyphs. Some of it looks like shorthand. And what was fascinating, though, his four-year-old daughter, when he asked her what it said, it's about the new earth, Daddy, and where we're going, and it's in a different universe. Now, remember, this little girl is four. Mm-hmm. And then he said to her, well, have the stars got names? And she said, no. She said, you wouldn't know the names. They're not the same as here. Now, he said to me, this isn't as though this is something he talks about to his daughter. Mm-hmm. One of the interesting things she also mentioned was when she saw some pictures of the crop circles that he was looking at, she said to him, oh, she said, the scaries make those, obviously referring to the ET beings. Mm-hmm. Now, these are coming from 4 and 5 year old children that have no access to any of this kind of information, are coming out with some really complex understandings. And when you've got 8 year olds, as I have someone locally here, a little 8 year old boy mm-hmm. who came to see me with his parents because he was remembering consciously going aboard the craft, being in a capsule where he couldn't move, and saying, blue being, he could see the blue beings. And I said to him, do you know why you're there? And he said, yes. He said, it's my yearly medical exam. And he said, we also learned things on the spacecraft. He said, I'm there with, and I said, who else is with you? And he said, some humans, some are not quite like us, he said, because they have different shaped eyes. And we're being taught how to use our brain waves, which is his term for it, to create things in the air and to do things in the air. So he was talking about learning about black holes, about other universes. And he said, and I said, you know, what beings, do you feel connected to any of these beings? And he said, yes. He said, the mantid insect-like beings are my family. Hmm. Now, he was quite clear with this. And he said, I also see the lion beings. He said, they're there as well. But the mantid are my family. And when I go up on the spacecraft sometimes, I evaporate into my manta body. And I said, how does that feel? And he said, well, it feels a bit strange. He said, but that's okay. He wasn't confronted by it. He got very emotional because he said that when he dies, he will go back to his manted family, and extremely emotional about this. And I said, is there any other things that happen? He said, yes. He said, I can see things around people and plants. And he says, and I talk to animals. And I communicate with animals. And I said, so you understand what they're feeling and thinking? He said, yes. And I'm here to help people understand that it's important to that we are connected to animals and that what they say is really important. And so he really explained two things that he is here for. One of them is to help his family wake up, and for us to understand animals and how we are connected to everything. Now, this is when he was 8 years old. Mm-hmm. So these are the kinds of things the children are saying. There's no hypnosis. This is conscious recall. This is, you know, this is their reality. And one of the things he said to me when we'd been talking, he said, so you mean I'm not crazy? And there is an 8 year old questioning his sanity because he lives in a world where he has to be careful what he said. Because I asked him, do you ever talk to the other children that you see up on the craft at school? Because he knows the ones that go up there with him. And he got upset and he said, no, I wanted to, but mummy stopped me. And his mum said to me, I just didn't want the children or anyone else to think there was something wrong with him, so I was trying to protect him. That is the scenario, and this is what people need to understand.
So would you speculate, Mary, that the planet's population now is pretty much half and half, half star-seed children and half what can be considered, you know, the people who, you know, come here to reincarnate to work out their karma?
Interesting. That's given the information that I got from a 9-year-old in Northern Europe with her mother, who was a linguist who speaks three. Her mother wrote to me because her daughter speaks three star languages, mm-hmm. and one of them she speaks at water to purify water. Mm. Her mother says she heals water. This little 9-year-old I call Kathy. Mm-hmm. Kathy told me when I asked exactly that question, Martin, how many now are what we would call star seeds, star children, children of the, as you said, indigos, crystals, children of light, rainbow children. Mm-hmm. I put them all under that particular framework. She said 50% of those coming to the planet. Now, this is a 9-year-old giving me percentages. She said 50% come to this planet now that have that. Are star seeds. But she said, unfortunately, due to schooling and other ways of programming people on this planet, at least, she said, only about 20% retain their light. What she's saying is that the rest have end up very confused about their reality and their mission and their purpose. She said, schools program you out of your light, mm-hmm. was her term, which I think says it all.
And if it's not the schooling, it's the medication.
Mm. Absolutely. Absolutely. And this is where we go into the medications for the so-called dysfunctions of ADD, Asperger's and others. Mm-hmm. And this is another area that has been really fascinating to me, because over 14 years ago, a young starseed who does the most amazing geometric drawings told me about the new children and how they are learning, they can have an ability to override the dominant conditioning and programming that happens here. And they have superior mental and analytical capabilities to do link to the subconscious and superconscious and their connection to the universe, and they have enhanced DNA, etc. Mm-hmm. I was fortunate to connect with Dr. William Brown, a molecular biologist, a couple of years ago, and I asked him, from his perspective, if any of this made sense. And he had no problem in saying that he believed genetic modification is occurring now in utero and is actually producing a new human. And the hybrids, he said, are altogether a new species. And he said, this is shown by the exponential increase in autistic ADD indigo children. There's a new genetic architecture that allows them to see the world in a multidimensional fashion. And he believes research would show dormant genetic regions are being integrated into the biological system in all of us to produce expanded awareness. And their brains work faster, they have access to more information, and learning is much faster, and they already know what's being taught. The information is encoded within the atomic structure of the DNA molecule and can be accessed with greater efficiency and produce savant-like characteristics. So basically, I mean, he's given me a lot more information about that, which I talk about in my presentations. Mm-hmm. But what was fascinating was it tied in also to a gentleman I met in Hong Kong who's a researcher, Neil Gold. And he told me that he was diagnosed as ADD, and he'd written his own book, Close Encounters of the ADHD Kind, because he said he always saw reality differently. And he's in his late 50s now, but the children, and I believe certain types of autism, I'm not saying all, certain types of autism and Asperger's, mm-hmm. are what another scientist who I call her LOG, because in her country, if she came out with this side of her understanding, she would have a lot of problems in that particular country.
Right.
But she is absolutely convinced that, as she calls the letter people, are an upgrade, or if they have more of the genome switched on. She confirms everything that Dr. William Brown has mentioned and calls herself a letter person, mm-hmm. which she said is literally, it's not like the genome has changed other than different parts of it are actually being switched on, which allow them to experience more of a multidimensional reality. And interestingly, many experience as children, you know, they'll either have an ADD or they'll have a child with autism or Asperger's, will say, my child says they see spirits or they see energies or they see the beings. And it's, you know, to me, I've got no way of proving this yet. Mm-hmm. But all I can say, it's an amazing synchronicity or coincidence that so many that have encounters are having children with these particular issues, if you like, or programs.
You know, it's interesting with what you just mentioned moments ago, where some of these children very nonchalantly describe the encounters with ETs as benevolence, having medical examinations and so forth on board the ships. But I'm just curious, if you ever come across the term container for describing the human body and the responsibility the grays have for maintaining the human body during the quote abduction unquote experience.
That's a big one, Martin, and it's so much more complex than the average person really understands. Mm-hmm. For example, one lady told me that she is aware of at least 165 species of grey alone. So it's like picking out one human and saying they represent humanity. So we have to be aware that there are many different types of grey. There are some that seem to be more workers, if you like. And we've got those that seem to have a lot more authority, a lot more awareness. I think they use... And this is exactly what some of the children mention and some of the adults, that they come into their human container. So really the biological system is seen often as an overcoat. To give you an example of that, just to it's still on the same theme, mm-hmm. is when I spoke to a young lady once who had a dual consciousness. She was aware of being part human, part ET. And she saw herself on a craft, but she was in a gray form, and she said, I'm working as a scientist on the craft. So I said, well, where is your human body? And she almost described it like it was over to one side, almost hanging there waiting for her. So I said to her, so how do you get back to your human body? And she described a ball of light that moved from the ET form right into her human form, and she said, and it sort of reanimated the human form. So she came back. She said, because in different environments, you need different containers, just like we would use a diving suit if we went under the water. Mm. Now, given that, I was working with a gentleman in England called Simon Parks, who also says that his family is the mantid beings, which was interesting working with a little 8-year-old. And the similarities between their accounts blew me away. Now, Simon Parks is a town councillor in England. And one of the things that he mentions is that he, when he goes on the craft, many times he will literally, his consciousness is moved into a mantid form where he helps with the humans. So it was quite fascinating that you've got a little boy talking about evaporating into the mantid form and a 50-year-old man describing exactly the same kind of process, only he had obviously a different way of speaking about it. And there does seem to be an understanding that we, as we inhabit a biological system, but we have the facility with our consciousness, our soul, spirit, whatever name resonates with you, can actually move in and out of this, and we can go in our light body, astral body, and go to other dimensions. We can go to other places, and then we just, when we need our human body again and we need the third dimensional experience, we re-inhabit it. And this is more and more the kind of account I hear from people who've had encounters, etc., etc. But getting back to the greys, I think there are many different forms, and I do know that they have the ability to do splicing, to work with our genetics, and there is a whole area of that at the moment I can only go with what the experience are telling me, mm-hmm. is how they can alter and change and heal our physical body. And often people who've had experiences on the craft will come back and a physical problem that they had would disappear, even to taking amalgam out of someone's teeth. A lady who'd had four amalgam fillings, and then the dentist said, well, I don't see evidence of them. And she can only conclude that they weren't helping with her her experience on this planet, and they had been removed. So there's so many things that go with this, Martin. It's really hard to put it into any real format yet, because I'm still gathering data.
Interesting. Now, I'm pretty certain you're familiar with the term resurrection technology. This is a term that was used a while back by Linda Moulton Howe in her lectures, and she mentions how, you know, this technology and how the Greys seem to possess this type of technology, where they're able to transfer the soul of someone whose body is dying into a much younger version of themselves.
Yes, and I think that one of the interesting things that I've discovered with those that have encounters is many of them look a lot younger than their age. And I found that quite fascinating, that they may look 10 years younger or 5 to 10 years younger. And I am wondering whether that actually relates to the fact that they can create clones of different people that are important to them. Mm-hmm. And if it's necessary and they still need them for whatever the mandate is, or whatever that soul's mandate is, they can move that essence we call spirit or soul into a new body. And this is whether the healing's done on the physical body that they have or they're given a new one, I think this has happened as well. So I think they have the facility to do both. If a body isn't capable of being regenerated anymore, or it's too sick, they can in fact change that. And one lady that I worked with, who lives in Melbourne, she was in her 60s and she had chronic back pain. She was on a cocktail of medications. She couldn't even sleep in her own bed anymore. She had to sleep in the lounge room because she couldn't get up the stairs. And overnight, after a strange experience where she woke up and all her gadgets weren't working, it was like all the batteries had been drained. She had a feeling something happened, but the strangest of all was she found she wasn't in pain, that all these medications were no longer necessary. She was able to dance again. She was able to do all these things. And when I did a regression with her, we discovered that she'd been taken up and they'd obviously done a healing procedure, as well as actually take her to her star family's planet. She was shown where she came from. She was also shown how she... all the scripts that she had found herself writing, she had learnt these on the craft as part of her information from her star family, if you like. And now she says her job is to wake her family up so that they understand who they are and what their purpose is.
You know, it's interesting because I had spoken to Barbara Lamb last month, and we discussed how, you know, certain people describe the alien encounter as terrifying and so forth. And once they're under hypnotic regression, they remember that there's a soul contract with these beings that they made on the other side. And oftentimes, they forget when they're abducted, so to speak. And the experience is terrifying, but you know, once they relive the experience, they begin to finally realize, oh, okay, I had an agreement, you know, with these beings to help their race, their gene pool, and so forth. And I'm just curious, have you, in your years of research and doing hypnotherapy, have you encountered the same scenario?
Absolutely. And in fact, it's one of the questions that I ask once they're in trance, because it's very important they understand the bigger picture in terms of their encounters. So at some point in the regression, I will ask them, have you on any level consented to this experience? And 9 times out of 10, they will go back to prior being incarnated, where they see themselves, you know, as a ball of light or a ball of intelligence. And they will say, yes, my contract was to come here to have the human experience, but also to actually assist my star family in certain understanding of what's happening with humanity and human consciousness. They almost see themselves, if you like, as one lady who actually was a walk-in who said, I'm like a double agent, really. What I'm doing is actually giving them an understanding of what it's like to be human, the human psyche, and what's going on this planet. And they actually, some of them at least, recall going to a particular council, if you like, to relay the information that they have gained by being human or whatever. But it is fascinating how, you know, that they will realize the big picture with this and how that changes everything in terms of how they understand their experience. Mm-hmm. And often, as Barbara knows, that, you know, their fear is often the fear of the unknown. It isn't actually the fear of what they've understood happened. It's often, I just don't know what happened, and that's scary. Once they go onto the craft, they see what's happened, and many of them will dialogue with the beings and ask questions of, you know, how often have you been to see me, and what's happened there. And what they discover is often a lifelong connection to some of the beings that they meet. And, you know, with some, the fear, I remember working with a 64-year-old lady in England who had had fear all her life. And so we asked, in hypnosis, where was the origin of the fear? And it went right back to when she was 2 years old in the cot, and she woke up and she saw two mantid type beings. And when she saw them, this created this huge amount of fear within her. And so she said to the beings, what are you doing? And they said to her, we're only observing you. We don't mean you any harm. Hmm. So this lady had this fear from something that never happened. And when I said to her, are you ready to release the fear now? And this woman said, of course, because nothing happened. And we did a process where she released all this fear. And it was quite funny, you know, she was a 64-year-old lady. She says, it's the first time I remember in my life where I feel like a new person. She was dancing around the room in elation that the first time. And she said, I've had nothing to fear because I've been working with them all my life. And now I understand. And it can be as profound as that, Martin, that can be something that happened as a child that is still part of the fear. When they understand it, everything changes.
That's interesting. Now, in the course of your research, Mary, have you ever heard of the term Project Serpo? This was an alleged exchange program between the U.S. government and extraterrestrials from Serpo, a planet in the Zeta Reticuli star system. And if you ever seen the ending of Steven Spielberg's film Close Encounters of the Third Kind, there is this scene which shows a group of human beings being prepared to board the alien spacecraft. But it's interesting that the ETs instead chose the character played by Richard Dreyfuss. And it's funny that the ETs chose this character because if you paid any attention to this ending of the film, it seems that, you know, as a result of, witnessing an alien spacecraft and having that encounter, it seems that he's losing his grip on reality, that there's this disconnect between his reality and the world around him. And I'm wondering if there's a tie-in to the star children and their disconnection to their surroundings in that they're, you know, perceived as having learning disorders.
I think that it could very well be that. And and what I'm finding too is that some of the experiences themselves are losing they have this kind of disconnect to everyday reality in the sense they can't relate to materialism anymore. They can't relate to the everyday life and say to me, you know, I feel completely distant from that because none of it makes any sense anymore. Mm-hmm. And, you know, with the star children, they actually have a sense of such a greater reality that they were, you know, they find themselves, you know, when people are cruel to animals, for example. I mean, one gentleman said to me, I can't even step on an ant, Mary, because I just can't do it anymore. The alienation, and excuse the pun, that they feel to the average, what I call human, is really quite profound and disturbing. And many of them struggle to stay here the young, I get many young starseeds, you know, particularly teenagers, that are wanting to be the same as everybody else because that makes them feel normal. But knowing that they're not, and many of them will go towards drugs and alcohol to dumb themselves down so that they can somehow manage to operate here. I have emails where people have said to me, and at least a couple have said that if they hadn't heard this information in the way that, you know, I do these interviews and hadn't heard about some of the things that I'd been saying, they said they were very close to taking their lives because it was like, nobody understands. I don't belong here. Nothing makes sense to me. What is the point? I might as well just leave. And it was, you know, basically a thank you for the information that they're not on their own, that there are, I believe, millions of people out there now that feel the same and just think it's them. Mm-hmm. And all they really need is information to know that things are changing and people are now beginning to connect. And the other thing I want to say here, Martin, mm-hmm. is the term awakening. So many, and I'm getting emails from all over the globe, from, you know, Hungary, Poland to South America to Japan. And the term they use is, I had my awakening 2 years ago, or I had my awakening 18 months ago. Everything in my life is different now. My whole motivation from before is gone, and I am totally focused on, I have got something to do, but I don't know what it is yet. And this is the start of something very profound, I think, in humanity now. There is this shift of awareness and shift of consciousness. And, you know, the ones that are having their awakening, you know, Dolores uses the term the sleepers. It's a very good term. And I think there have been many sleepers out there that have known there's something greater, that have said, I knew I had something to do here, but I still don't know what it is, kind of feeling. And this is, I think, you know, what we're in the midst of now, a huge awakening amongst the human population to who they really are. And what needs to happen to make this planet the way to become what we want for our future, for our, not only ourselves, but our children, our grandchildren.
Mm-hmm. Now, you also state that the parents have to communicate to these star children differently. Is it because of their telepathic ability?
Absolutely. If you, I remember the 13-year-old little girl saying to me, Mary, when I'm at school, mm-hmm. and when the teacher is telling us something, what she's thinking is something quite different. And sometimes what she's thinking isn't very nice. Now, if that teacher had any idea that this young lady could pick up her thoughts, she would be certainly editing what she's thinking about. But I think there's a huge lesson here that we have to realize how powerful thoughts are and how they can affect everything around us. And these children know when they're lied to. They know when you're not telling the truth, and you can't fool them. They'll know energetically, they'll know through their own abilities. So, you know, you've really got to start coming from the right kind of place. And what is interesting, too, is for those covert agencies or the embargo on the truth, whether, and they know about it, that these children also know what they're doing and what the, and what isn't coming from, you know, what we would call the love space. They absolutely know how we're being manipulated. Even a young 9-year-old, the mother told me the 9-year-old's son is particularly focused on what we're not being told. And she said, he's only 9, but he's told me already that the moon's an artificial object and that some clouds are actually craft. And that he also knows that the way that President Kennedy died, he understands exactly what went on there. Wow. Now, these, you know, so watch out, guys. Those of you that try to manipulate humanity, some of us may be still not listening to our inner voice, but this is now about listening to that, and the children are giving us the lead, which is really beautiful.
Well, what about chemtrails? Are they sharp on the fact that these are being done by, covert, in this case, the covert government, the secret governments, to change or modify the weather? Are they aware of this?
Oh, I think they're aware of that and a great deal more. Mm-hmm. I'm speaking to a beautiful young lady who calls herself a Homo Novus. She said the Homo Noeticus came in 2000, but we're heading towards the Homo Novus. And she said they have the ability to manipulate matter. So even with health, they have the ability basically to alter everything within their own physical system. So if something is ultimately unhelpful to our physical body, creating illness or whatever, they will actually be able to alter it and change it again, right through to this little girl saying she can purify water simply by speaking to it. She realizes that there is something in the way of the language that she speaks. And the mother said, you know, the water, Mary, does taste differently. It does taste different. And this mother is a teacher and a linguist. She's a highly aware lady. Mm-hmm. And she's saying that, you know, her daughter has said that both her and her little brother have come in as teachers to help humanity change. And that's an interesting one too, that they are aware that they are here to help the older generations, to help us understand the truth, because they have that conscious awareness of their superconscious information. It doesn't have to be provided via trance or any other altered state. They are automatically connected to that awareness.
You know, I find that very interesting because, you know, you mentioned moments ago Dolores Cannon and her work and the three waves of volunteers that did volunteer to come here and help, you know, raise the consciousness of the planet. Mm-hmm. And it's interesting because she mentions that, you know, the soul, or in this case, many souls, heard that call to help the planet. Mm-hmm. And they were very eager to, mm-hmm. you know, do this and this and this at certain points in their lifetime and so forth. And, you know, they pretty much, this is the way Dolores explains it, that they kept telling themselves, you know, I'm going to do this. I'll remember. You know, my spirit guides are telling me this. Mm-hmm. I got to do this. And all of a sudden, you know, once they're born on the planet, they forget everything. And I think I can qualify myself as being part of the first wave mm-hmm. of volunteers and so forth. But she also mentions that, you know, the first wave were the way showers, those people who were forging the trail or blazing the trail. Mm-hmm. And of course, the second wave are those transceivers or antennas that somehow are there just to give off energy and so forth. But what you just mentioned, it's just so interesting because these young children, they have this certain urgency. They know exactly what they're supposed to do. And they push aside the silliness, let's say, of television and so forth. Mm. In effect, the way I see them is that they're kind of like old souls, right?
Oh, absolutely. And very, very aware. I mean, the interesting thing from this 9-year-old that I loved was, you know, she was mentioning that the languages that she speaks come from somewhere outside of the universe. Wow. And she said, and really, she talks about dayland, eveningland, and nightland. And she said in dayland is where the light lives. And she said something, and that's where her friends come from. Mm-hmm. And she said that she's got two helpers, a blue being, which she calls a Moku, and a green being, which is male. But she said something really about God that was interesting to me particularly. She said, we all originate from dayland. And she doesn't want to use the word God because she said it's misused. She calls it a being in daylight, an over-terrestrial, where we all originate. It's not a man or a woman. It has no gender. And she said, this being sowed the seed of light and love only, and it's where the light and the angels live, which is fascinating to me in the way that she describes it. But she also is aware that she's here to be part of this wave of helping to wake people up. And the information that she's got, although it's described as books in one way, she describes it, the understanding of this information that she has access to and is taught by. And this is also what I'm hearing from others, that they have this other education in the non-physical realm. And she said that she's got access to 7 books. The red book is about creation and our origins. The brown one is about different planets and life. The light green one is about nature and how we can make contact with plants and animals and how we understand nature. The dark green one is about the body and how it really works and how we get it to evolve. The blue book is about light and truth. The red book, and this is fascinating, she said she can't open this one yet because a dragon took the key from her sometime in the 1700s. Huh. And the black book is about darkness and evil. And she said all the books contain important information. And so what I'm hearing is that these children are having a completely different education from this planet, but is one that is helping them to understand the matrix, to understand our multidimensional nature, and they're connected to all this information. And that's why they argue with the teachers and with people in authority, because what they're being taught here isn't correct, not in the way that they understand it.
Well, I heard you a while back mentioned, which perked my curiosity here, that everything is shifting in 5 years. Can you elaborate more on this?
Well, this is something that's come through a number of, again, the children. Mm-hmm. This particular young lady, Kathy, told me that she was given the information that the major shift will happen between 2012 and 2017. So it was a five-year space. Mm-hmm. Similar reports have come from a number of people from various parts of the globe, some adult star seeds and some of the children, that we are very close to some major event, major shift. And it's very hard to know exactly what that is, because they all say that we can't actually fully understand it or how it will manifest. Other than one of the scientists that I'm in communication with that has her information from what she calls the cone heads. She's a credentialed PhD who has a wonderful understanding of the biology of the body and healing and water. But she said that we're separating out, she said, into two frequencies, the low frequency people and the high frequency people. And she said, and if you want to, and everything's about choice. You either stay with the low frequency and you continue to eat rubbish food and be part of the materialistic world, or you make a choice to raise your frequency so you can be part of this other awareness. Now, whether or not that means that, and I can only hypothesize that ultimately there may be something like this new earth where there's going to be those of the high frequency choose to be in a different state of being to the ones that choose still to have a third dimensional reality. I don't know, Martin. I mean, there are so many theories. I can only look at what's coming into me and see the patterns that I'm being offered. Mm-hmm. And there is certainly a sense that we are close to some kind of shift, and I can only say in a shift of consciousness.
Okay. I was just curious about that here. And would you believe that these children are protected by higher intelligences?
I'm certain that they are, because one of the things that this little nine-year-old said to me was that she had to be careful about exposing herself. And one of the reasons that I say Northern Europe is I don't even give a country for this particular individual. I also know another family that their 10-year-old son, mm-hmm, was, he was going and saying certain things at school, like, you know, you teach in a linear fashion, I think in spirals. He was writing formula and telling me that when he was 7 or 8, he was given formulas to create portals. The parents had to move him from a school because he was being tested without their knowledge. And he was aware that he was being pushed to deliver information to the school authorities that, in fact, didn't feel right. And they actually moved him. So there is no doubt that they know about these children. But I think the biggest problem for them is the numbers now. You can't keep tabs on potentially millions and millions of these children that are out there now.
Right. You know, you also had cited how much information is being downloaded into these children. And I had interviewed a while back Stan Romanek, who under regressive hypnosis, he was able to write down these complex mathematical equations, dealing with physics and so forth. And amazingly, you know of some children who have also done this, and I'm just wondering, is there a reason why the mathematical part is out there?
Absolutely. And interestingly, when I looked at some of Stan's, mathematics and the drawings that he did, I noticed similarities to this 10-year-old boy whose parents had sent me some of his mathematical information. And it was really interesting because some of it actually looked the same as Stan's, which was interpreted as portals, which this little boy had talked about. The interesting thing is, with many experiences, they have downloads of different types of information. Some of it seems to be time locked, and this is something that comes through in regression. The reason that some of the symbols, when we've wanted to get more information, they've been told that they're time locked, which may mean that when we get to whatever event it is where there is that shift in consciousness, that information will then be made available, I suspect. My feeling, the other thing that is really important here is a whole range of information comes through experiences as downloads, from scientific information to spiritual information to a whole array of information that is about our multidimensional universe, including complex physics, et cetera, that is coming through. The main difficulty seems to be for people that are, not involved in the academic world or whatever, struggle to know where to take this kind of information. And a beautiful teacher who contacted me was fortunate enough, she had over a few weeks downloads from the light beings. And she actually was in the right kind of environment to ask a gentleman who was the chair of physics at Cambridge University to look at all these equations that she'd been delivered. And he said, "This is mathematics of at least 200 years of into the future," was his response to that. And a similar response was from the chair of physics at Adelaide University. So, this is credible information. And sometimes it's even beyond, who they've sent it to, who may be an expert in their field. But what's fascinating, I think, to do with the time-locked information, these downloads that nobody can quite access, my sense is that if we are going to have various parts of the genome switched on, if you like, because we only use, what is it, a tenth of our brain, we only use 5% active we know of our DNA at the moment. If we are actually switched on, our hard drive is a new type of computer then that will need new software. And I believe some of these downloads that people are getting that are time locked are probably the software for the new hard drive that's switched on. And that is why we can't access them yet, because we're not able to, if you like, understand them until we have those parts of ourselves activated. And this is just purely a hypothesis in looking at the patterns and being as logical as I can be, given the nature of my work.
You know, it's interesting because you mentioned seven books. I believe, what was the color of that book that was taken away by the dragon?
Oh, yes, that was the one of the books that she said was taken away in the 1700s by a dragon. Isn't that interesting? You've picked up on that. She said because a dragon took the key from her sometime in the 1700s.
What color was this book? I'm just curious.
This particular book is the red brown book. She can't open yet.
The red brown book. You know,
Yes.
I heard you mention that, what came into my mind was the forbidden fruit, similar to the Adam and Eve in the Garden
Yes.
of Eden.
Yes.
That's interesting. I don't know
It's
why that.
very, very, you picked up, I picked up a similar feeling around that, Martin. I just, and I feel that it really is significant in terms of how much we're not told the truth on this planet, and how we're being prevented potentially by some other intelligence that is trying to redirect humanity, perhaps. Who knows?
So, in your opinion, Mary, is humanity really poised to become upgraded? You know, to go from, let's say, Homo sapiens to Homo noeticus to Homo novus.
Yes, and this young lady who has conscious awareness of many of her past lives. She remembers being here in Atlantis. And she said she's come in as a Homo Novus. And I asked her, what kinds of abilities do the Homo Novus has? And she said they don't have a human astral body, for example. They have an ET body. They have super strength and durability and stamina, super flexibility, and they're natural acrobats. They have hyper healing, high immunities, high temperature resistance, high pain tolerance. They have heightened physical senses in sight and hearing, larger brain capacity. She said Homo sapiens of 10%, Homo novus 20%. They use astral sensors even while in the physical body. In other words, their third eye. Teleportation abilities, for example. They're quick learners. They access their soul memories, universal knowledge, huge empathic abilities, telepathy, mind control. They can use that if they need to. Telekinesis, levitation, psychokinesis, heal and create illness, and remote viewing, etc., etc. So these are some of the abilities of these new children.
Fascinating. And have you ever heard of the term Homo Galacticus? This was a term used by, I don't know if you're familiar with this entity, but he goes by the name of Bashar, as channeled by Daryl Anka.
Yes, I've met Daryl, actually, and I think that Bashar's information is some of the more credible of some of the channeled information. Mm-hmm. I like the energy, I like the information, and there's been nothing that hasn't resonated with me whenever I've heard Bashar. I think that, the information for me has a lot of integrity.
Interesting. Okay. Well, we are approaching the end of the first hour here, Mary. Would you care to remind the listening audience of your website and how anyone can reach you should they be interested in contacting you?
It's very easy. Just Google Mary Rodwell and my website comes up anyway. But it is the Australian Close Encounter Resource Network, which is ACERN. And so it really is very, very easy to get in touch with me. And there are many contacts on my website, so that you can get directly to me with my email.
Okay. Any closing comments you'd like to make for the listening audience for the first hour, Mary?
I would just like to hope that the material and what I've been speaking about, actually, at least, even if it doesn't all resonate with you, that at least some of it might, and that whatever it is that fits for you, you continue on your path of gathering as much information to understand yourself.
Great. Well, I appreciate you taking the time here to chat with me for the first hour, and I'll see you again for the second hour.
Thank you.
Thanks again, Mary. Take care, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Goodbye.
Bye.
That's it for the first hour on As Above, So Below Radio. Tune in for the second hour by subscribing to holisticadvocate.com, where Mary will further impart information on how our species will transition from that of Homo sapiens to Homo novus, and how such a leap will metaphorically be similar to a new software requiring a new hard drive and operating system. How language can alter our DNA. How the pyramids at Giza were built by the cat people. And the intriguing reality of factions among the Greys and reptilians, and much more. Thank you. You're listening to As Above, So Below Radio.